Good morning. I'm Jill Zielinski, Director of Supports Coordination for the ARC Alliance, and your host for today's program of Building Bridges in the Community, brought to you from the ARC Alliance. On today's show, we'll be doing the third part of a three-part series that we'd started to go a little bit more in depth with a little bit more detail into the services and supports available through the Office of Developmental Programs. With me again today are our guest supports coordinators, Linda Chesney. Linda, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
And Emily Smith, also our supports coordinator. Hi, Emily.
Hi, Jill.
Nice to see you. Thank you.
Thank you. So those of you who watch the program know that I like to start off with the ARC's mission statement. And the ARC Alliance envisions a society that has appropriate supports, services, and safeguards for all people with developmental disabilities so that they can fully participate in our community. We strive to ensure that legal protections are upheld, developed, and utilized to further more inclusive and supportive communities. The ARC Alliance believes that all people have the right to participate in society, to be productive, to develop and maintain relationships, and to have the opportunities to pursue their dreams. Currently, there are over 6 million people diagnosed with an intellectual or developmental disability. 1 in 110 children are currently diagnosed with autism, which makes it more prevalent than childhood cancer, juvenile diabetes, or pediatric AIDS combined. In the state of Pennsylvania, there are over 16,000 people on the waiting list to receive services through the Office of Developmental Programs. And in Berks County, there are over 3,000 women and adults and children that participate in the Office of Developmental Programs. And there are also currently over 350 people within the emergency category of need. So today we will be discussing more services and supports that are available through the Office of Developmental Programs. And we're going to start off today with Linda, who will be discussing assistive technology for us.
Thank you, Jill.
Thank you. As
Jill said, these activities, assistive technology, children and adults with developmental disabilities may be helped by devices and computer aids known collectively as assistive technology, acronym AT, in their everyday activities. Now, AD covers a broad range of products, such as remotes for electronic devices, talking books, or computer aids, like a keyboard for computer keyboard, that helps guide individuals' fingers over the correct keys, or an adaptive mouse. You can go on websites and find a comprehensive list of AT products. Now, down at Temple University, they have a Pennsylvania's initiative on assistive technology, and they call it PIAT, P-I-A-T, and they offer a variety of activities. They have that you can actually borrow different things there, and you can call, if you have a pencil and pen, you could take a phone number down and call them, and they will actually let you borrow something before you buy it. And that phone number is 1-800-204-7428. That device, they will show demonstrations. And you will have a hands-on opportunity to learn more about the different AT devices. And like I said, you can also, Emily, you can take them out for loan before you go and buy them.
That would be fabulous, because then you'd be able to figure out which ones are going to work best for your particular individual, or
sure,
for you yourself if you're looking into buying or
sure,
one of those products.
Because they can use them at school, they can use them at work, you know, if they have a job. And
super.
So that's where we are, Jill. So thank you.
Thank you. And Emily will be talking to us next to discuss the environmental modifications to someone's home, and this is, includes the home adaptations and car vehicle adaptations. So Emily, can you discuss environmental modifications for us?
Yes, I can. Thank you. Home adaptations are to modify private homes, including homes that are owned or leased by parents or relatives that an individual lives in, which, due to the individual's disability, are necessary to ensure their health, safety, and accessibility in the home. This can only be used, realizing, at least through the ODP, they can only be used to adapt the individual's primary residence. It can't be used to adapt homes owned or leased by, say, provider organizations. Adaptations here have to be specific to the individual with the disability, to be an item of modification that the family would not maybe necessarily have in their home for a non-disabled person, but an item that's maybe a general maintenance of the home. It can be the installation, the repair, maintenance, even including extended warranties would be covered under this type of a home adaptation. You can't add additional square footage to a home as an adaptation. That's not allowed. Unless, of course, it's required to, say, make a bathroom large enough to accommodate a person in a wheelchair, that will be included, or that's okay. Neither is durable medical equipment. That equipment is wheelchairs or shower chairs, things that are usually pretty mobile. Modifications, as I've said before, have to be specific to the individual's needs. And they're not to be sort of a benefit to other people in the house just because. Some of these modifications can be things from ramps from the street up to the sidewalk or the house, or maybe an outside railing from the street to the house. Handrails in the house or grab bars in the bathrooms. Sometimes people need some help in getting transferred from one portion of the house to the other. Those can be either portable or track lift systems to get them from, say, bed to a bathroom or into the living room. Widening doorways to make it better or safer so that they can get a wheelchair through. Also maybe working on those landings in somebody's home or in their hallways to make those wheelchairs accessible to different portions of their house. Bathroom modifications, for instance, for bathing, showering, toileting, or any of your personal care needs are also included. Electronic systems sometimes are considered home modifications that would let a person access, control their appliances like lights, doors, and security systems. There are also vehicle adaptations that can be made for the wheelchair-bound individuals that we serve through ODP. Those are going to be lifts into the van, special clampdowns for chairs to make sure that they are securely in place when the vehicle is in motion. And those too can be applied for through ODP. And those are about it, Jill, that I can think of.
Well, one thing that I did want to mention when it comes to that is that there is a limit on the amount of money that can be used for it. During a 10-year period, it currently stands at $20,000. So that will include any modifications to either your home or vehicle with that limit of $20,000 within the 10 years. And another aspect that I think now might be a really good time to mention is that to receive many of these services through the Office of Developmental Programs, known as ODP, you need to have, especially in the case of assistive technology and home or vehicle adaptations, you will need some estimates for the work being done, and also at times they want to see a denial letter, actually two denial letters through insurance for a lot of this equipment. So if you're looking at, for example, a handrail in the bathroom, you would need to go to your doctor first, try to get a letter of medical necessity, and then submit that to your insurance. When it's denied, you appeal the decision, receive the second denial, and then we'll need those two denials before we can submit for the waiver funds to pay for this. And later on in the show, hopefully we'll have some time to be able to discuss waiver funds, but I just wanted to take a minute and just explain that specifically for the assistive technology and the environmental modifications like home or vehicle adaptations that we do need at times a letter of medical necessity and two insurance denials before we can submit to have waiver pay for it.
So in addition, Jill, for people who are not familiar with any of these assistive technologies, there are professionals out in the field who can go and make it a lot easier. They can come into your house and give you guidance insofar as what they think would be necessary in order to make that person's living there safer and healthier. So yes, there are professionals who know how to do this.
And you also mentioned about the estimates.
Yes.
Right, currently they need 3 estimates from different providers in order to have the best one.
Thank you very much for clarifying that. And we're actually going to go back to Emily right now, where she's going to discuss the behavioral specialist supports.
Thanks, Jill. Behavioral specialist support personnel come in to help the needs of an individual in specific. These are provided one-on-one. And what a behavioral specialist person does is they come in to try to find out exactly what a person needs in the way of counseling, therapy, help for their behaviors. They develop strategies to support the individual based on the assessment that they do. They also, after deciding what needs to be done or what could be the best course of action to take for that individual, they'll also go in and train parents or other staff or other caretakers on how to take care of that individual. The specialist is supposed to have a master's degree in human services or a closely related field so that the Office of Developmental Programs know that they are fully qualified to be able to work with the individuals that they serve. Some of the things that they're going to do in order to make sure that they're working in addressing the needs of that individual are these. They're going to collect some behavioral data, find out just what it is that the person needs help in overcoming. They'll observe the individual in various settings to develop a behavioral support plan. This will take into account collaboration with participant, with the family, with the team, to put a plan in place that must include positive practices with no restraints. They conduct comprehensive functional assessments or presenting issue aggression, serious injury behaviors, and law offending behavior. These issues are found in a lot of our clients due to the fact that they have a hard time communicating and they have a hard time letting people know what their wants and needs are. And so often they'll turn to negative behaviors in order to get their needs met. Through a behavioral support person, we can begin to dissect what those behaviors are and what targets them, why are they doing what they're doing. After the behavior support plan has been put into place, looking at the aggression issues, some of the what we call SIBs, which are self-injurious behaviors, we'll go on and conduct training with the people who are going to be involved in that person's life to make sure that they understand the plan and they understand what the people are supposed to be working on with that individual. There will be activities and strategies identified in the plan to help that person with the behaviors. We'll be monitoring the implementation of the plan, and it'll get modified when needed. At least yearly, these behavioral support plans are updated to reflect any progress that the individual has made in overcoming their negative behaviors. And of course, with anything related to our business, there's lots of data collection to make sure that we're actually meeting the needs of that individual. There are progress reports that go out to team members. And there's another, at the end of the year, there's another annual plan that comes up to see that the person's needs are being met and that the behavioral therapist is making progress with the individual. These services can be done in the home. They can be done in the behavioral specialist's office. They can do it in day programming or out in the community. So that's where we are with behavioral support services.
Thank you so much, Emily, for that. And we will be taking a short break, so please join us back in a few seconds. Thank you.
You're watching The Arc, Building Bridges in the Community on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information on local issues, go to bctv.org.
Thank you so much for joining us again today. And I'm Jill Zielinski, the Director of Supports Coordination for the ARC Alliance, bringing you this program today, Building Bridges in the Community. And with me are Supports Coordinators Linda Chesney and Emily Smith.
Thank you, Jill.
Right before we had gone on the break, we were discussing some of the extra services and supports that are available through the Office of Developmental Programs, known as ODP. The show today is the third in a three-part series where we went a little bit more in depth into the different services and supports that would be available through the Office of Developmental Programs. We started, the first part of the series was residential possibilities. The second part, which Emily and Linda took part in, we talked about employment and day opportunities. And today we're discussing the other services that are also available. Right before the break, we had discussed the assistive technology. These are things like communication devices, keyboards, remote controls, also environmental modifications like home or vehicle adaptations. These would be needed for, say, handrails, or an example would be a ramp, or in a car, a wheelchair lift, that are available. And then right before the break, we had discussed the behavioral specialist supports, which are individuals that specialize in challenging behaviors with our individuals. So we're going to move on now to Linda, who's going to be discussing our residential habilitation. Linda?
Thank you, Jill. Residential habilitation, that is where in the home they increase their independence with daily living skills. Communication, to learn how to communicate with each other and with their caregiver. Socialization, they do that in their home, and by doing that, they can, if it's a group home, they learn how to interact with one another appropriately. They go out in the community and do socialization. They learn skills to live in the community and know what's appropriate, as we would in the community know not to throw trash on the ground. And you just walking and saying hi to each other. While they're in their home, they can learn cooking skills. And maybe that's just a matter of putting something in the microwave and warming it up for dinner, or making their lunch when they go to the day program. They can work on bathing and make sure that they're doing that properly. And they do that nightly or in the morning. Eating a healthy diet. Mobility. Once again, walking safely throughout their home. They also learn in the residential habilitation housework, keeping their bedroom clean. If it's carpeted, they learn how to use the vacuum cleaner. They learn how to keep their room cleaned, and all the food items, of course, stay in the kitchen, so they help in the kitchen, helping clean up after their meals. Shopping, if they like to earn that money, they like to go out and go shopping and get some individual things for themselves. All these things in the home, they are goal-driven, and they have to work on these skills. Sometimes they have to work on them daily. Sometimes they may have to just be worked on at least twice a week, but they have to have documentation. So if they have habilitation staff, they have to make notes daily, or they have to make notes every time that they work on them. And it could be, Jill, any time. They could work on them anywhere from a half hour to an hour. It all depends on their ability to work on them.
Absolutely. And the reason why I wanted to pair residential habilitation with the next subject that Linda's going to talk about, which is respite care, is that, in a way, they're almost two sides of the same coin. For residential habilitation, it's where the staff are going to be working on goals, on the individual becoming more independent in their home, making sure that they're healthy and safe, that they're eating right, cleaning the house, dressing appropriately, everything like that. And then the flip side of it is respite care, which is care to ensure that the individual is healthy and safe, but not necessarily goal-driven. So, Linda, could you discuss respite care?
Sure. Respite care is as simple as giving the caregivers of the disabled person an opportunity to have some time away from their daily responsibilities of providing care. It has become an important part of the strategy of managing the best care for the entire family. So if you have an individual living with their parents, and it's day in and day out of the care, sometimes people need a break from each other. So respite care is frequently identified as one of the most needed, and sometimes this is a difficulty in finding available services for families. So in this sense, the family can contact numerous providers to inquire about the respite care that they can provide for their individuals. Or the family, if they have a supports coordinator, they can call us and we can help them find that. First off, insurance can be pursued for the use of a home health aide to provide hourly respite for an individual. So we have hourly respite in the home, or sometimes they can take them out of the home and do things, or overnight with a qualified provider to give a caregiver a break in having responsibility of their individual. And you may be hesitant if you have your child at home and you don't want to go out into the community and find somebody. So if you have a neighbor or a friend, they can also be hired by a private agency. And in that sense, you would have a fiscal agent, and you would be using funds from the Office of Developmental Programs to do this. But once again, we, as supports coordinators, can help you find that. So thank you, Jill.
Thank you, Linda. You did an absolutely fantastic job explaining both of those options. Next, Emily, could you please discuss home and community habilitation?
Home and community habilitation is offered to an individual through ODP in order to go and ensure that the individual has the opportunity to learn the skills to live both in their home and in the community. Oftentimes, home and community hab is provided to clients or individuals who are living at home with their family members, and they need some help in some of the skills building that would normally come about for a typically developing person. They need to learn how to cook for themselves. They need to know how to get a shopping list put together. They need to learn how to operate certain equipment in the house, whether it be the TV or whether it be the stereo. Home and community habilitation works to ensure that an individual has a knowledge of their greater community, go out and learn how to take public transportation, how to get to the grocery store, what are they looking for in the grocery store, shopping for that and purchasing it and bringing it home. Making, when they get home, they've cooked their meal, now it's time to learn how to clean up, how to get their bed made, how to, it's a number of different items or skills that we have that we go through each day that we don't even think about. But with a developmentally disabled individual, it's a learning process. They have to figure out or be taught how to run the laundry, what are the trash days, how to take the trash out and set it up appropriately.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Were you going to say something?
I was just going to say about the laundry, you know, actually working the washing machine, how much detergent to put in, and how,
right,
what dials to put on. And then once the machine's done, to take it out and what to put in the dryer and what not to put in the dryer.
It's very complicated. Mm-hmm. Jill?
And one of the final things that we were going to talk about real quick is known as community inclusion, which is, in a way, in a manner of speaking, it's a specialized form of habilitation because it is working with the individual on a goal, or known as an outcome, and in order for them to become more independent. But community inclusion is specifically for helping the individual access their community at large to whatever level they are most comfortable with. So this is where we get into how to buy stamps, where's the post office, where's the mailbox, for example, accessing public transportation, bus routes or train routes. So it's any of those skills that are designed specifically for accessing the community we call community inclusion. So thank you so much for joining us today, where we discussed the other services available through the Office of Developmental Programs. In order, we had begun with assistive technology, which these are devices needed to help an individual access their direct environment, so keyboards, remote controls, items like that are assistive technology. Then Emily spoke about environmental modifications, which are the home or vehicle adaptations. These are where the ramps came into place and the railings and any kind of safety equipment like a wheelchair lift for a van, for example. Then Emily spoke about the behavioral specialist, which creates for us the behavioral support plan and teaches the team how best to deal with challenging behaviors. Linda next talked about residential habilitation and also respite care. Anytime anything's called habilitation, it is going to be goal-driven, and respite care is a break for the family and the individual. So thank you so much for joining us today. With me are our sports coordinators, Linda Chesney.
Thank you for having me.
And Emily Smith.
Thank you very much.
And I really appreciate that you were here. Please feel free to call us at any time with your questions and comments at our Eagleville office at 610-265-4700, or of course on our website at www.thearcalliance.org. So I'm Jill Zielinski, the Director of Supports Coordination for the ARC Alliance, and I look forward to speaking with you next month. Thank you.